any time you could come to the altar, that's between you and God. And just worship Him or whatever you're needing. You're free to come. If you have your Bibles, I'd like you to open to Matthew chapter 2. We talked about the birth of Christ last week and all the things that Mary and Joseph went through and what Jesus really come, what a present and a gift He is to us, that He covers everything that we need, and there's nothing that we need that God doesn't take care of. And the thing, if you think about this, and I was trying to figure where I heard this, but it was on the Wednesday night videos that we're watching, that God created the heavens and earth. And He made everything that a man needed even before God made a man. So He don't have to wait until something happens to create it. He's created everything in the world that was possibly needed for a man or a woman to use. And it was here. He didn't panic. It was done. And He said, it's finished. And it was good. Everything that He made was good for us. And we got to understand that God loved us so much that He sent His only begotten Son. But He created this whole world for us. And even He knew that we would need a sacrifice. That we would need somebody to take the burden of our sins off of us so we don't feel guilt and shame all of our life. And that sometimes leads to depression or something like that. And I think we're all, you kind of fight that going through this thing because things just aren't the same. And, you know, people are missing. And we think, oh, where's Isla? Where's all these people that we just love to be around, you know, that aren't here? And I think sometimes we don't recognize that. And maybe it's something God wants to work on us with, to enjoy them. You know, we haven't seen the Sullivans since it started. Well, I've stopped over. But I haven't went in the house. So, you know, try to keep in touch with them and everything, but we understand why they're doing what they're doing. It's because of Sam. You know, and even she has to go out and teach. Well, I don't think she is now. I think she's teaching online, but there was time she was going to the school, and then they was concerned about Sam, you know. So, anyway, I think a lot of times we don't really understand what God has done for us as a whole. And if you took one day, I bet you couldn't get it all in to write a list of what He's done for each of us. And what is, you know, for our lives. How He has lined up people in our lives to make a difference. If a certain person wasn't in your life and they was bringing blessing to you, your life would totally be changed. You realize that? So people are important, and God has chosen to use us as ministers of reconciliation. That reconciling people back to God through Jesus Christ. And that's what it's all about. And that's the gift that God has given us. And sometimes we look like it's a burden. But when you see one soul changed, it makes a difference. It makes a total difference. So, in chapter 2, from the very beginning, that even Jesus was going to be born, and when Herod found out about this, he was threatened that somebody might take his kingdom away from him. So, the first thing he wanted to do is he wanted to really kill this baby. So his kingdom wouldn't be in jeopardy. I know you've never had those thoughts. start off in chapter 2. It says, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the time of the King Herod, the Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, where is the one who was to be born King of the Jews? Now they was asking where he's at. And this is what stirred Herod up. It's because they wanted to know where this King of the Jew was. And that he might be king of all people. And that threatened him. Have you ever had anything like that? You know, just where a jealousy comes in your life that's not good. Whether it's in business, whether it's in your relationships, whatever it might be. And then fear takes over. And look at Herod's thoughts. He apparently didn't know everything he needed to know about Jesus, or he wouldn't have been threatened. And you know, that's the same thing with unbelievers. They know enough to make themselves miserable. They don't understand the whole gospel, that Jesus come to bring peace, and Jesus come to help you. He's the mighty God, the counselor. And he come to make a difference in your life. Had Herod known, had the religious leaders known, they wouldn't have crucified him. But envy and jealousy and all those things that are not of God entered in and caused them to fear. Now we should have a righteous fear for the Lord, a reverence for him, and understand he does discipline us in different areas of our lives. So, but if you pull back all the curtains to see what really Jesus come for, you know, it's kind of like a stick of dynamite. If you don't know how to use that, you could get hurt bad. Amen? But for people just to know, this week, I had a man come to my door knocking. My life is never boring. And he wanted me to take him to a certain place, so I took him there. He said it was a family emergency. It wasn't a few minutes later, the sheriff pulled in my driveway and wanted to know, is your name Kim? And I said, yeah. Did you take some person somewhere? And I said, yes, I did. I can tell you exactly where they're at. And so they went, and he ended up getting arrested. He said, well, he's got a warrant out for himself. But I did get to share Jesus with him. I asked him, do you know Jesus is your personal Savior? No, I got a godmother that's told me about all this. And I says, well, you need to learn more. Because sometimes when we don't know everything, it messes us up. You know, I was wiring a week or two ago on a Monday, and I went up and I turned the breaker off, and I thought that was the breaker. I took a pair of nippers, and I, guess what? I threw the nippers. I was up in the attic. And I threw the nippers. I had to go get the metal detector to get the nippers found. I'm a fun person just by myself, you know? My life's never dull, you know? So we've got it with every time we get an advantage to share the gospel, that's what we need to be doing. We need to be sharing with people that don't know. And then I got another, I went Thursday. Remember when it was real foggy? Thursday, I went by this guy's house again. Guess what? He's out there waving me down. So I pulled in and he wanted to use my phone. And I says, well, just for your information, I'm not the one to call the cops. Okay? Yeah, it's all good. I needed to go. Okay. I want to start new and afresh. So I prayed with him. You know, you can't let things like that just hinder You've got to jump on them when they're there. So don't forget that, because we've got the best thing that there is, and that's Jesus, to make a difference in people's lives. And that man told me, he says, I want a new start, a fresh one. And I says, well, I can tell you how to get one. Give me my phone number, you know. But the bottom line is, who have we told about Jesus? Now, not like Herod, because he wanted to kill him because of the jealousy and the envy that was in him. Verse 2, and asked, where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw the star in the east and have come to worship him. You know that supposedly that same star is going to show up on the 21st. They're merging together. And I was looking in my, when you study something out, study Bible, we'll go with that. Okay, and it said in there that a lot of astronomers, a lot of the people now believe that it was Jupiter and Saturn and possibly Mars that come together for that star that they noticed in the sky. And it's not the astrology that we think of that's weird. You know, back then, they didn't have GPSs, you know. But even these magi was looking for that person. Are you looking for Jesus today? Do you got something that Jesus has got the answer to in your life? Sometimes we think that God ought to look us up. Well, I think in a sense he does. He puts people in your life to make a difference. Or he speaks to you. Or he shows you things. And we've seen with Joseph that he had a dream. And then the angel appeared to him. However God wants to do it in your life, he's done it with me in dreams a lot. And that are spiritual and they just don't go away. You've got to have an answer because it's bugging you. But are you searching for Jesus? Because if you're hungry, you're going to find yourself at the dinner table, aren't you? More than you should be. My wife done that thing with Sherry, Carol, and everything. She's got magnets on. It's not here on the refrigerator. What you're looking for is not here. Sometimes we have to be reminded of that. And then when King Herod heard this, he was disturbed in all of Jerusalem with him. And when he had called together all the people's chief priests and the teachers of the law, and he asked them where the Christ was going to be born. In Bethlehem in Judea, they replied, for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judea, are by no means least among the rulers of Judea. For out of you will come a ruler who will be the shepherd of my people, my people, Israel. That's in Micah chapter 5. Do you realize that prophecy was given 700 years before Jesus was born? 7 centuries before Jesus was born. And all the Jewish people knew the Messiah was coming. They just didn't expect it to be Jesus. Even in they knew where it was supposed to be born, and even when Jesus fulfilled the prophecy, they still doubted. And you know, that happens to us a lot of times when we're, you know, people watch us grow up. And what brats we was. Maybe you wasn't. I was. And then all of a sudden God gets a hold of you. And something changes. But some people wouldn't listen to you, and you wouldn't listen to some people because you know their past.
seen a thing on Facebook this morning. I'm going to mess this up probably, but it said if a backslider comes back to church and all you're thinking about is their past, you're the one that needs to go to the altar. Hello? We judge people and we don't even understand we're doing it. And sometimes it's out of ignorance. Sometimes it's out of rebellion, or we've been used wrong, or whatever. We get bitterness, and don't let the root of bitterness get in your heart. Because it'll destroy you. It'll keep you from receiving from the Lord. And see, we have to understand that. We're only responsible for us. Okay? We need to hold each other accountable. But it's how we do that that makes the difference. When it's done out of love. And so that's the basis thing. But Jesus is everything we need. So they knew where he was going to be born. Verse 7. Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go to make a careful search for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so that I may go to and worship him." You know, sometimes we come into a service and we're always wanting to be ministered to. We have the wrong attitude from the very beginning to come in. And the whole thing of it is, we're here to minister unto Jesus and each other. There's a time in our adult spiritual walk that we've got to quit taking all the time, and we got to start giving what God has and just quit being takers. And sometimes we just worship God for the wrong reasons, to come here in the house of the Lord. But don't you know that he lives inside you? The Spirit of God is in you. So when you take him to places and you're saying not good things, complaining about this or complaining about that, whatever you're doing, and then all of a sudden you realize, hey, the Holy Spirit's in me. What's our attitude? How are we seeking Christ? For just what we can get? That's not what we should do. We need to seek him for who he is, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. We need to honor and worship him. And this is what the Magi come to do. Herod's motives was not right. They was evil. He really wanted to kill Jesus. Now listen, John 10:10, the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And that's all the devil offers to you, and sometimes we fall for it. And we don't recognize who he really is, even though the scripture tells us that sin is going to cause you to stumble. And it seems pleasurable for a moment, but then after that, you feel cheap. Kind of like being on a diet. Go to the refrigerator, you grab what you don't need and eat it anyway. But my theory is, when we have a family dinner and it's a holiday, those are the free days. Verse 8, so he sent them to Bethlehem, and he said, "Go and careful search for the child, and as soon as you find him, report to me, so that I may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them until they stopped over the place where the child was. Now you got to realize, they went thousands of miles, what my study book said, as I studied this out. They had been walking for a long time. Jesus was probably 1 or 2 years old, is what it said. And they had traveled afar. And we complain we got to drive a half hour to church.
or it's too hot or it's too cold,
or this or that, or whatever.
You know, if you really want to seek God and want to seek God, what He has for you, you've got to spend time with Him. You've got to spend time
building that personal relationship. Because until you get that personal relationship, it's just religion.
That's all it is. You come to church to make yourself feel better. The people that led me to the Lord only came to church
because they was afraid their mom would find out and they wasn't in church and she would call them up that afternoon and kind of chew on them a little bit.
But yet, even in that,
they led me to the Lord.
So God can use us no matter what. In whatever situation,
God can use us.
Verse 11, and on coming to the
house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and they worshipped him. They had opened the treasuries and presented him with gifts of gold, of incense, and of myrrh.
And having been warned in the dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. Now listen. They was on a journey to find Jesus, and they found him. He wasn't very old when they found him. They knew the purpose that he was supposed to come for. But yet he had not done anything yet. And they had come to worship him. Is your heart there? What if Jesus never done any more for you? Would you still worship him? Would you take time out of your life?
These guys must have been rich.
I don't know what they did for income, but the whole time they're following Jesus. But when they got there, they had
gold and myrrh and all things. And you know, I wrote this down and said, gold is a gift for a king.
Incense is a gift for deity. They come to worship. They come to make a difference.
To understand that there's somebody bigger than them. And our society isn't teaching that at all.
You're a God. You can do anything you want to
do when you want to do it.
And you'll end up in hell. Because why? Because you don't know the truth. You don't know the gospel. People perish because of the lack of knowledge. Do you understand that? And when we get the opportune time to share the gospel, to share Jesus with somebody, we need to do it. Because you may be the difference between eternity in hell and eternity in heaven. And isn't everybody worth that? That's what we've got to ask. They was willing to travel thousands of miles to find Jesus. And how much? On camel? Maybe they had fastback camels, I don't know. Only I would think of that. But the whole thing was, the gifts that they give was all about worship. And when we walk into this place, when you spend time alone, you know what I find?
When I am empty
of the Word of God,
being in the Word of God and everything,
life is draining me. And what builds me back up
is being in the Word of God.
Either hearing it
from somebody else teaching it,
or reading it myself. And when I'm in there and I'm worshiping God, all of a sudden, all my problems seem to go away. They're not as hard as they was. Couple weeks ago, I told my wife, man, I'm just down. I don't know what's going on. So I told her, I'm going to spend more time in Word and stuff. And then the next week, guess what? I felt better. You know, it builds you. It builds your faith. Things don't look as dim as they do. And I think we're all suffering from some of that through going through this virus. Nothing's the same. You just can't do what you always did. And now we're going to learn not to take that for granted. To being around the people that aren't here. And I understand they need to keep themselves safe. And if you question it, you need to stay home. But the bottom line is, who are we worshiping and why? That's the question, two questions we've got to ask. Who and why are we worshiping? Where did I leave off? Remember? Now I'm coming to the house. They did their
job. Okay.
And then they went back a different way because guess what? They was warned in a dream. The Herod was going to do something not nice.
Now listen, I want to kind of take the liberty of once you meet Jesus, your direction will change.
They was planning to go back, but they chose not to go back because God intervened in their life. And if you don't like the way your life's going, you need to get into the Word and meet Jesus and strengthen you. Because then he gives you a better direction to go to make a difference. Not only in your life,
but in others' life.
They saved Jesus' life by not going back. But that's not the end of the story. Because in verse 13, it says, and when they had gone, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream.
Wait, that's not it.
Did I flip my page? No, that's right.
13. Okay. They appeared to Joseph, and get up, he said, and take the child and his mother and escape to the Egypt.
Stay there until I tell you.
For Herod is going to search for the child to kill him.
You know, the enemy is always out to steal, kill, and destroy. Because he's threatened and he's full of pride. And that's what got Lucifer sent out of heaven, because he was prideful. And if you really look at every sin in your life, it starts with pride. Because I want this. And I think I should have it. That's what our society is telling everybody. It's just the opposite of what
Jesus tells us.
He came to serve.
He didn't come to be served.
He should have been. But he came to serve.
And he did it in a way that none of us will probably have to ever do in our lives.
We take a little bit of criticism. But I think the way this country's going, the church is going to be persecuted.
I've already seen it in some of the CBN News. I watch them. It's a Christian news. And I watch them, and already people are trying to tell Biden what to do.
And I really believe that
if things don't turn, persecution is coming.
And it's nothing new, because even here, from the time Jesus was born, he had a death sentence on him. But you know why? God turned that sentence into something great. And you have to realize he can take you and turn you into something great once you meet Jesus. How would you like to have Jesus' job? His ministry. Knowing at the very end of his ministry, 3 years or whatever it is, there's dispute about that, but whatever he ministered here on earth, knowing at the end that he was going to be crucified, the worst death that could ever happen to anyone, the slowest death, the fiercest death, the most painful death, somebody says something bad about us and we get all upset. We ain't got a clue what he went through for you and for me. So verse 14, he got up and he took the child and his mother during the night and he left for Egypt, and where he stayed until the death of Herod, and also fulfilled what the Lord had said through the prophet, out of Egypt I will call my son. And when Herod realized that he had been outwitted by the Magi, he was furious, and he gave orders to kill all the boys in Bethlehem and its vicinity who were 2 years and under, in accordance with the time he had learned from the Magi. Then what was said through the prophet Jeremiah was fulfilled. A voice is heard in Ramah, weeping and great mourning, Rachel's weeping for her children, and refused to be comforted because they are no more. That's what happened. He went all the way through the area and killed every baby. But you know what? God had a way out. He sent his son to Egypt before it even was going to happen. And some of us don't know what the world's going to be by January. And we're worried about it. And there's a lot of bad things going on. But back in Jesus, when he was born, they was killing babies left and right. We are, through abortion,
what is it,
6 million? Six, I forget what it is. They've been killed. And they could have been preachers, ministers, whatever God had for them. There is forgiveness for that. But there also has to be repentance for that. And our nation will be judged because of that. I really believe it in all my heart. And even this could be a part of what God's doing. Either God's going to turn it totally around or he's not. But you know what? God's still God. And we still serve him. And if it's not turned around, then you know what? It's going to give us a great time of ministry. Because the next thing that's going to happen is the rapture. Who do you need to talk to before that happens? Everything has taken place. All the prophecies have been fulfilled, except for building the temple, rebuilding the temple. And they already got all the clothes and everything they need for that. And they've even, I've heard, they've made a replica of the... It's gone. What is it? The mercy seat and where God was and the everything. Oh, come on, King. Anyway, so even this time, even when Jesus came, it was a terrible time. And we read last week, we like Jesus looked and had compassion on Israel because they looked like they was harassed. You feel harassed, political today? All the sin that our country's okay in, we need a shepherd. And God sent Jesus. He sent his one and only begotten Son, and he gave him for us to make a difference. And I even read in my study Bible, and it says that even the gifts that was brought, the gold and everything, probably helped pay for the trip to Egypt and back. I never thought of that. You know, camels don't use gas, but, you know, you still have to stay somewhere, and you still have to have food, you still have, you know, all the things, the everyday life that we do. And after Herod died, an angel, verse 19, the angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt
and said, "Get up and take the child and his mother and go to the land of Israel, for those who are trying to take the child's life is dead." And so, if we drop down to about verse 20, well, it's just 21. "And he got up and he took the child and his mother, and he went to the land of Israel. And when he heard that Archelaus," whatever, "was reigning in Judea in place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. After being warned in a dream, he withdrew to the district of Galilee, and he went and lived in the town called Nazareth. So was fulfilled what was said through the prophets, he will be called a Nazarene." The Micah prophecy was 700 years before Christ. But yet God fulfilled every prophecy of the coming of Jesus Christ, so that he would have to go to Egypt. He would have to come back. He was going to be tried to be killed, so he left to Egypt. And then he went to Nazareth. And God had a plan. You don't know, that's what we need to hear today. God has a plan. No matter how the world goes, God has a plan. He made a way. You know, I was thinking about this last night, because he made a way to get Jesus where he needed to be saved. And you know, God does that for us. Sometimes we don't realize why he's doing it, but he does it for us. And he's going to do it for us again. Amen? If we need to be saved in these next years, God's going to take care of it. God's going to do it. So we need to trust in him, no matter what the world. And the darker the world gets, the more we ought to shine, until the rapture comes, where God takes his church out. And then the Antichrist will be revealed. Things are not going to be pretty. We've had 1 year of some tribulation, and we made it. We don't know the total outcome. Now they got, we've been praying for an antidote and whatever it is, and now they're passing it out to all the help, the people that are on, working with people and everything. But we made it. And some people from church have even had the virus. And as far as I know, nobody's had it bad. God is good. I don't know what you're feeling inside, because in these times it is so easy to get depressed, because we want God to do it our way. But look how he prepared Jesus for his beginning of his life. Even how it was prophesied how he was going to come, so that people would know. And yet, they didn't know. That's what we got to be careful of. Not understanding the times. Missing Jesus in our life. Not taking Jesus people that we need to take them to, so that they can have the same rest we have. Amen? That's our job, church. You don't have to wait to find somebody that has a warrant for their arrest. It should be an everyday thing. The Magi was searching for Jesus. Are you? And if you read Matthew and Luke, the shepherds were searching for him. Wise men searched for him. That's what the Magi was. They were supposed to be wise guys. Not in the sense that we are, but you know. So the hope that we have in Christ Jesus, to realize even when this world looks terrible, that God has a plan. And who knows? Maybe the rapture is coming soon. But God's going to take his people so that they don't have to go through. You know what's puzzling to me? You read Daniel and you read Ezekiel and you read all the prophets that, you know, talk about the end times. We know that it's going to go to one world government. And that's where they're trying to push us now. One world leader and a one world religion. And there's already religions lining up for that. Did you know that? Our people perish because of a lack of knowledge. So we need to be searching the scriptures. We need to be listening to somebody that knows more about Revelation and knows more about the second coming. And we need to be finding all out what, and I've listened to different people and they have different.
A lot of people say that Rome's
the seven hills. There's seven hills in Rome,
you know, and that's going to be the Babylon that's
destroyed. There's another guy that said it's the United States because everybody is going to weep when the United States is taken out in a day.
Because of all the products we ship to and fro. And the Bible talks about that. I don't care which way it goes. I just want to be with Jesus. Amen? And you know, it gets me, the disciples walked with Jesus. They lived with him. And yet he had to correct them all the time about their beliefs. You thought I was saying this.
And I wasn't saying that. This is what I really meant.
I feel like that as a pastor.
Lord, how long should I be with them?
Jesus said that. And Moses did it. Moses said, God, kill them all. Then when God wanted to kill them all, he said, no, don't kill them. They won't think you're a big enough God to bring them in to the land and partake of the land. We all get flustered with that. With life. But you know, Jesus come to give us hope. And what we celebrate this season, he's the reason. What we have to look for is the same thing we talked about today. Our attitude for serving Jesus. How is that? Do you come just to get all the time? Or are you willing to get to work for him? Are you coming to worship him for just what you can get? The Magi took stuff to Jesus. Amen? And you know, I had a pastor, I said to him,
he said, I don't care what your life's like, and maybe everything I've said to you is just tearing you up on the inside. But you know what?
Every day is a new beginning for everyone in Christ. Amen? Don't you ever forget that. And if you get down and out,
you need to think about that.
What Jesus did for us. Because I get down and out sometimes. There's times I get worried of the labor. But yet Jesus tells us, hang in there. And you know something? Just when I was ready to give up and didn't give up, God brought a breakthrough. I don't mean that I didn't give up
every time.
Because sometimes I do give up. But my hope is in him and in this word, the word of God. Amen? If you don't know Jesus as your personal Savior, and if you know him but you don't know a lot about him, make it a personal relationship. Spend time with him. Even if you're just being quiet and pondering what you just read in the scriptures, you have to do that. And then you'll start to notice him speaking to you through your spirit, in your heart. I've only heard the audible voice one time. Of audible voice I heard in the physical. The rest of the time it's always been in my heart or it's been in my mind, thoughts that are coming in there. And how many of you know if we don't take our bad thoughts captive, they will wear you out and drain you. And that's
part of the devil's scheme that he wants to discourage you, to steal your relationship with Jesus, with Christians, and with God. But you know something? God knew this all before, and he made it our ministry, a ministry of reconciliation, to reconcile people back to God through Jesus Christ. That's our mission, people. That's what God has for us to do. Amen? Let's stand there, please.
You know what? And don't feel bad
about feeling that way, because we're in the flesh, right? That's why God is in the spirit. And we need to understand that
our flesh is willing, but it's weak. How many of you know that?
Then why do you listen to it all the time? God says them things to me. You know better than that. How many times have we said to our kids, "You know better than that"? How many times, guys?
He's turning around smiling. Oh, God's good, isn't he? Mm-hmm.
All the time. If you're feeling down, don't sweat it. Jesus is in control. Okay? And the world is trying to tear us down. And you know what? It's been that way since Jesus was born. They was trying to kill him. And the devil thought he did. See, I just wonder what God's got planned. Because even in the crucifixion, God was laughing at the devil. Because he wasn't smart enough. He just thought he had Jesus there. But you know why? Jesus never sinned. We struggle with that because we was fleshly. We was made of the flesh. We was made in sin. And that's why the Holy Spirit had to come upon Mary. So there was no sin. Everyone else that does it the other way, man's flesh, woman's flesh, guess what? Sin is already entered there. That's why Jesus did the sin. But yet he was man. But yet he was God. Amen? It is so deep when you start thinking about it. If you'll just take an hour, 15 minutes, to think about everything that God has done for us in all creation, and what he's doing now, and what he has for us. I'm sure God has a mighty plan. And one day we're going to wake up and see it and say, why did we sweat? You know? Why was we worried? Well, Christians don't worry. They just concern. Okay? Because worry's a sin. You know that, don't you? Because it's not faith. And anything we do without faith is sin. Hello? It gets deeper. So that we need to stop and meditate on the Word of God and how true it is. You don't know Jesus, don't leave here without him. If you know him and you need to go deeper, only you can go deeper. He says, if you draw near to me, I will draw near to you. Amen? So we've got to take the first step of faith, seeking him like the wise men did. And they didn't seek him just for a little while. Jesus was 1 or 2 years before they got to him. I'm not smart enough to figure that out, but there's people that read study Bibles that is scholars. And you know I ain't no scholar, right? All right. Let's pray. Father, your word is so precious. Sometimes we take it for granted. But yet, Father, just to look at the details that you used in the birth of Christ, where he was to be born so that people would know, where he was to come out of, to went to be saved in Egypt, and then he come back to Nazareth. And Father, all that was written hundreds of years before it even happened so that people would know.
So Father, give us understanding in these days. I really believe, Father, these are the end days. And Father, you have a plan for us. And Father, you will protect us. You will be with us. Because you promised in your word, Father, and sometimes we forget the simple things that you promised. You said, I would never leave you or forsake you. Father, we've had friends and enemies that have left us and forsaken us. And Father, you have never, you and your Son, the Holy Spirit that lives in us. We forsake you, but you never forsake us. So Father, draw us closer to you in this time. We know that this isn't the time that Jesus was born. But Father, if we didn't take time out to worship you, to know the true meaning of this season, it's all about you and your Son and what he come to do. And he hadn't even done anything yet. And yet people were seeking to worship him, not for what he could do for them, but Father, what he meant to them. Let us worship like that. Now, Father, protect each one as we leave this place. Be with those that are going through hard times, those that need healed, Father. We just pray that you would touch them. People that are seeking for you, Father, open their minds and their hearts to you, the gospel, the good news. Father, we need good news. Let us take it to others. Now, Father, bless each one that's here. Bless them as they come and bless them as they go. You have a plan for them, and Father, you will fulfill that purpose if they follow you. And we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Greet two or three people, and you're dismissed. Could I?